ku rindu orang jauh tak lupa dari kenangan hati ku rindu orang jauh Fikiranku sun berisau-risauan sakit untung ditinggalkan abang ibarat kapal.
Zo, saya punya dah live kan?
Yes.
Tapi saya tak nampak keluar dari Facebook saya, Cik Zul.
Okay, boleh mula.
Dia tak live di Facebook lagi.
Boleh mula.
Double check.
With all the participants, just give us another minute for us to sort out some IT issue. Okay, salam sejahtera to all our panelists and participants. I would like to have several housekeeping messages for all the participants in this room. First, of course, if you are having any questions, you can type your questions in the chat box. And me as the moderator will read out your questions to our panelists. And I would like to say thank you for joining us this afternoon for this Dengue webinar, which is organized by Academy Professor Malaysia. I'm Dr. Chi. I'm the moderator for this webinar. The title of our webinar today is Dengue in Malaysia, Taking a Backseat During COVID-19. Now, I would like to quickly just briefly introduce our panelists. We are very honored to have three panelists today with us. First is Professor Dr. Johari Surin. Maybe, Prof, you can wave your hand.
Assalamualaikum.
Yes, thank you. And second, it will be our Associate Professor, Dr. Tan Toh Leong.
Hello, everyone. Nice to meet you.
And our third panelist is Dr. Siti Aisyah Mokhtar.
Very good evening, everyone.
Okay, so they will be sharing with us then their experience and knowledge in various topics on dengue. So before we start, I would like to actually share the current dengue situations. Today is actually 15 June. Today is 15 June is actually an Asian Dengue Day. This date was declared as Asian Dengue Day by Asian's Health Minister in 2011. So it's about 11 years ago. Just coincidence, today we are having our dengue webinar. Now, just would like to share with you the current situations on the worldwide, the dengue cases. You can see majority of the dengue cases for the past 3 months is focused in the South America, especially Brazil, and followed by Southeast Asia, Malaysia, Philippines, and Vietnam. So, the situation as update on the 2nd of June, more than 1 million cases and 849 deaths have been reported. As you say here, majority of cases has been reported by Brazil, followed by Peru, Vietnam, Indonesia, and Colombia. How about Malaysia? So in as of 7 May, Malaysia recorded 13,651 cases with 7 deaths being reported. How about our neighboring country? Singapore. Singapore, as of 28th of May, have reported 11,674 cases. However, I would say luckily there is no death have been reported. And recently, there is a news on the CNN indicating that Singapore is facing a dengue emergency as ripples with an outbreak of the seasonal disease that has become and that has come unusual early this year. So it's an unusual shoot up cases in Singapore. So Ministry of Health Malaysia has actually come up with this flyer and to educate the public that amalkan pembuangan sampah ke dalam tong sampah. So this is very important. Later on, one of our panel will share with us why it's so important to mengamalkan pembuangan sampah ke dalam tong sampah yang betul. And what we want to say that is tidak peduli if let's say you just simply throw your rubbish, then maut menanti. What is indicating of pembuangan sampah yang tidak munasabah? This is what is going to happen. So we just simply throw all the plastic cup, plastic whatever around the floor, which later on it will actually capture the water from the rain and it will become a breeding site. In more details, one of our panels will share with all of us here, how are we going to do what we can do to protect our life and also our friends and families' life from this dengue. So today's Asians Dengue Days, the theme is Let's Stop Dengue Now. With this, I would like to actually introduce our first panelist is Associate Professor Dr. Tan Toh Leong from University Kebangsaan Malaysia. Dr. Tan is a consultant emergency physician currently working at the Department of Emergency Medicine, Hospital Chancellor Tuanku Mukris, University Kebangsaan Malaysia Medical Center. He is the current president and founder of the Malaysian Sepsis Alliance and Steering Committee for Asia-Pacific Sepsis Alliance internationally. His research interest, okay, is in sepsis infection, emergency critical care, translational research, point of care test, molecular biology, and antibiotic stewardship. He is now working closely with WHO and Global Sepsis Alliance aims to create a world free of sepsis. He will be sharing from the clinical point of view on dengue, especially the signs and symptoms and his experience in the emergency department. Dr. Tan, the screen is yours.
Thank you. So basically, today I will have a chance to share with you how, especially for public, I think a lot of people come to hospital and they are not sure whether they are having a dengue or not, whether they should come to hospital or not, whether they are just a normal fever that they actually no need to hassle themselves to wait in the hospital, right? So currently, because Malaysia, everywhere is endemic, yeah, it's hotspot for dengue, especially in KL area. Recently, especially now it's raining season, the, you know, the drainage part and also the a lot of breeding site for the mosquito to happen. So I think this is good for us to share some tips for you. How to suspect yourself whether you are having a dengue or not. So let me share a slide to show you some of the signs and symptoms of dengue. Let me share the slide first. So I hope that everybody can see the slide. Yeah? Yeah, could you see my slide? Yes, okay. So this is quite a simple chart so that if you are suspected yourself to having a dengue, you should have some of these signs and symptoms. First of all, must have fever, definitely. For our points of view, if you have fever atau demam more than 3 days, 3 hari, then you need to see whether you have other symptoms or not, such as like headache, atau sakit belakang, backache, and also joint pain, as well as some rashes. The rashes quite typical. Later on, I will share to you some of the picture, how the rashes look like. Yeah? And also, you have bleeding. The bleeding is quite rare, like gum bleeding or bleeding from other side. Other than that, you feel tired, lethargic. letih, keletihan atau lesu. And as well as you have sakit perut, cerit berit, and muntah-muntah. These three, cerit-cerit, muntah-muntah, is more typical for Malaysian breed of dengue. Because currently we also look into these three signs. This sign symptom actually is quite serious if you have a persistent vomiting, persistent perut sakit, and also persistent cerit berit lah. So if you have a few of this sign, you should come to hospital to have a check or go to the klinik kesihatan terdekat to check your blood. Maksudnya ambil darah di klinik kesihatan terdekat, ya. How you expect that you if let's say you suspect yourself is dengue and then you go and do your blood test positive of dengue. Okay, don't be surprised that doctor will send you back home. Yeah, not all dengue patients need to admit. Yeah, so I will show you some of the you will expect yourself to have a fever for the first to fifth day. Yeah, okay, but usually fever will start to subside at day four, which is after your first day of fever, and then you have 4 days of quite a high grade fever, usually very high grade. You have those chills, you got very tired, you have very painful joint. Yeah? Every 6 hours, definitely you take some medicine for fever release. And at the day of day five and day six, you start to have, feeling better. And then you feel the fever is going off without any medicine help. But this is the time where the danger set in. Yeah? A lot of people thought that hari kelima, hari keempat, tak ada demam lagi, no more fever. And then suddenly, they got a critical ill dengue patient. They come to hospital with bleeding. They come to hospital with all the sign of, darah rendah, shock. And then look very ill. So actually, dengue only danger at the day four and above. Meaning that when you are feeling well, that time is the most dangerous time that we need to look into. So you will expect the doctor, usually doctor will say, hari keempat, nanti datang tiap-tiap hari ambil darah. Tiap-tiap hari ambil darah. Ini you kata, saya dah baik dah, kenapa nak ambil darah? A lot of people will ask this question, kenapa nak ambil darah? Actually, dengue, when you're feeling well, is the time where a lot of dengue will bleeding lah, will have, shock, blood pressure low lah. That's why doctor will monitor you closely. At that time, they will call you to go to klinik kesihatan terdekat ambil darah tiap-tiap hari. Then they will check some of the blood parameter. Seperti your platelet lah, platelet ada darah yang darah platelet, ya, and also darah putih lah, to see your white cell whether it's too low or not. Darah sel darah putih, ya, kalau terlalu rendah pun tak bagus juga, ya. Then after that, then they will see whether you need to admit to hospital or not, because some of the blood parameter will give us like a warning, saying that you might need to hospitalize because I scared that you will have suddenly a shock come in, macam tiba-tiba kan perdarahan berlaku, tak sempat. So, then ada lagi, there's few warning signs that you need to know as well. Warning sign means that if you have this sign, you need to come to hospital. You do need to come to hospital. Doctor will give you a list. Usually all the dengue patient will give a paper, a chart, bring home chart, dengue monitoring chart. So you will need to, doctor will EC. Every time you take blood, they will fill in the form and then tell that your blood, your some of the result inside that. And also they will give you some advice when to come to hospital if you feel unwell due to this sign symptom, like such as like your persistent vomiting, and then you got this stomach ache, and also you got diarrhea nonstop, and also you're very tired. Even you want to wake up to the toilet or you want to walk to the toilet, nobody, you cannot walk up. Walk by yourself, then that is very bad. And also you have some bleeding, yeah? Start to have bleeding, you have to come bleeding a lot, not when you brush your teeth or some bleeding, no. If you brush your teeth, the bleeding non-stop, then you have to come to hospital. And also you have those, some of the, black, a lot of bintik-bintik merah, but because of doctor will suspect your platelet low, kita panggil platelet rendah atau darah putih tinggi. And also your blood is very thick, hematocrit. Kita panggil hematocrit. Sel darah merah terlalu pekat because of a lot of air tak cukup dalam badan, dehydration. So you need to come to hospital. So all these signs, some of them is need to doctor to see you, only can detect the sign. But yourself, if you have tired, too tired, terlalu lesu, atau perdarahan yang teramat, sakit perut yang teramat, sakit perut di tengah-tengah, atau cerit berit muntah-muntah tak berhenti-henti, sila datang hospital. This is the sign that you need to know. Okay, this is the rashes that typically for dengue. You will see the red color of the red sea, dipeptosis on the red sea. You can see the whole body is red color, only got spot of white color. Merah seluruh badan, tapi ada bintik-bintik putih. Tapi tekan, dia hilang merah tu. Tapi sebelah kanan, sebelah kiri sini ada satu lagi gambar. One more picture here is, you have a multiple small red color dot. This is called petechiae. Petechiae ni adalah, actually is due to our small vessel which is ruptured or because of platelet that's sumbat, that's clogged the small little vessel that cause a bruises, a small bruises, macam bintik-bintik kecil tu. This one, when you press, it didn't go off. This one, you need to make sure that you have been close monitor. At home ke atau doctor will see you from time to time. This is very, some early warning sign. But for red color of this, is okay. For the whole red without tetanus is quite okay. So penjagaan pesakit dengue di rumah. This one you need to know. Setiap orang perlu tahu macam mana jaga kamu sendiri di dalam di rumah, ya. Because we have so many patients in hospital, we cannot admit every patient, ya. First of all, you need to know is when you're at home, doctor will monitor you. We will give you a monitoring chart. Then we'll make sure that you will rest enough. Okay, you have to make yourself sleep most of the time. Don't do such activity like exercise, all these things, no need. Just fully rested. Berehat sepenuhnya. Number two, drink a lot of water, especially plain water. We suggest that if you don't show you how much you filter, you don't drink, how much you pass out the urine, you can drink how much. But usually we advise on 8 big glasses. 8 big glasses. And then after that, we need you to avoid from getting any bite from the nyamuk, the Aedes, especially. So we want you to sleep in the kelambu, the netting, the netting, so that you don't get bite and then transfer your dengue to other people. And also when you have fever, you need to get some antipyrexia. I mean, it's an anti-fever. You can give some paracetamol, and they can help you to reduce your pain over the body and also your headache. However, if you want to take painkiller over the counter, you need doctor advice because painkiller is a no for dengue patient. If you need the painkiller, is only in a special condition, doctor only can prescribe that. All right, so don't simply buy any painkiller or aspirin for yourself. Only paracetamol allowed. And now the last one is if you have all these signs in the critical, like just I said, very tired, sangat teramat lesu, cerit berit tak berhenti-henti atau muntah, sakit perut teramat tak pulih-pulih, ya. And also you have this terlalu muntah-muntah tak boleh makan, you have to come to hospital lah. And other than that, all the blood parameter doctor see lah. If doctor see the parameter, you need to come to hospital, you need to come. Okay, that's all from my side, so I pass back to Prof Chi. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you Dr. Tan for this sharing on the clinical signs and symptoms and what we can do if let's say you've been sent back home after seeing the doctor in clinic. Yeah. So if you have any questions, all our audience participants, you can just type in the chat box. With this, I would like to introduce our second panelist, which is Prof. Dr. Joharin Surin. Prof. Dr. Johari received his formal training in medical parasitology and entomology from a number of universities around the world, especially Australia, United Kingdom, Thailand, and Japan. So his research area is in medical parasitology and entomology, mainly cover the molecular epidemiological aspect of the parasitic infections, including giardiasis, cryptosporidiosis, and malaria, and so forth, filariasis, and also the soil-transmitted helminthiasis, forensic entomology, and mosquito vectors of disease. So currently, he is appointed as an honorary professor in research and development, IPPP, in University of Malaya. So his sharing will be focused on the mosquito vector that transmit the dengue virus. Welcome, Prof. Dr. Johari.
Thank you, Dr. Chi. Assalamualaikum and salam sejahtera. Very good afternoon to everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank the academic professor Malaysia for inviting me to share with the audience about dengue. And you know that in the past 2 years, we have been occupied with the pandemic of COVID-19 and dengue, which before this has always been in the news and has been quite quiet. So we wonder whether dengue has taken a back seat. So for today, I'd like to share with you about the dengue control. Okay, right. Pertama sekali, saya ingin akan berbincang mengenai kawalan dengue. Ada 3 perkara yang ingin saya kongsi. Pertama ialah mengenai vektor dengue. Keduanya ialah nyamuk Aedes. Dan akhir sekali ialah kaedah dan langkah kawalan Aedes yang ketiga. So we all know that dengue is very synonymous with Aedes mosquito. So it's very important for us to recognize the behavior and the characteristics of Aedes. The first thing that we all are familiar with is that the dengue mosquito, the Aedes mosquito, are day biting. They are mostly found in the morning and then in the late evening. So these are the female mosquitoes that will be around people and they are there to feed blood. So these being around us, they are regarded as a domestic breeder. They are mostly around houses where in urban dwellings and they have got the habitat in which they breed in where there are a collection of clear water. This is very important. And this water are contained in containers which are man-made, artificially made by man, or natural water containers. And then having fed, they need to rest, and they rest also in around human dwellings, so they are regarded as endophilic. And they are mainly found in corners of houses and dark corners of rooms. So Aedes are mainly, they mainly bite human, so they are regarded as anthropophilic. And which means that they prefer to feed on human blood. So another behavior about Aedes mosquito is that they bite more than one host. So they will rest on you and take a feed, and they can easily move on to the next host. So they are regarded as a fairly nervous feeder. And for Aedes, they need the blood to as a protein to complete their egg maturation. So for one cycle of egg maturation, that is the gonotrophic cycle, they feed for a couple of times. And so this is the behavior of the Aedes mosquito. And the other thing about Aedes mosquito is that the virus which they contain can be transmitted to the egg, to the ovary. And once the egg is being laid out, this virus is passed down to the next generation, to the egg larva and to the next generation of mosquitoes. So they are regarded as a transovarian transmission. Aedes, they are not very distant flyers. They can cover a radius of about 10 or 100 millimeters. 100 only. So here is a typical example of a principal vector of Aedes. This is Aedes aegypti. So you notice that this is a quite familiar sight, perhaps, I would presume that this mosquito is regarded as tiger mosquito ataupun nyamuk rimau. They have got very striking and white bands on their legs. And more importantly, you see this special light shape at the top of their thorax. So is only aegypti the vector for the dengue? No, there are other secondary vectors like Aedes albopictus, which is also found outside the house and in the jungles and in the forest. In other countries, there are other Aedes species also that act as vectors. So how does the mosquito breed? And they have got a life cycle. in their breeding sites. So adult mosquito, once the eggs are being matured, being processed after blood meal, the eggs are being laid at walls of containers, like dry walls of containers. These eggs here stick onto the walls. And once they are filled up with water, these eggs hatch out just within 2 or 3 days, and out come the larva. The larva will undergo a process of development from first instar to the fourth instar. They will take for about a period of 4 to 6 days, depending on the temperature and the humidity. And then larva change into pupa. And this pupa, within 2 days or 3 days, they will pupate into imago, which is young adults, and the adults will just will mature and will fly away for another. And the adults will live for about 2 to 3 months in a tropical condition. So what are the breeding sites? So breeding sites, I think, is quite familiar to all of us. They are Aedes mosquito. They like to breed in man-made containers. Example, like, you know, even in the house, you have flower vases, or you have water containers, which is open. So Aedes will start laying the eggs there. They can also be found in natural containers, three-hole breeders, and also in stagnant pools, and also in some areas. And obviously, where garbage are being thrown around, there are containers there. That's what Dr. Chi mentioned just now. If we leave any containers, that any containing vessels that can collect water, clear water, those are good breeding sites for this Aedes mosquito. Right? Aedes mosquito also depends on the factors of the environment. The mosquito actually fluctuates with rainfall and water storage. So when there's a dry season, you don't have the mosquito will go, what they call it, resting or diapause. And then even the eggs too can last for quite a few months. Only when it rain starts after a drought season, see the eggs will develop and hatch out into larva. So these mosquitoes survive best around temperature of 16 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius, and at a humidity of 60 to 80%. Even with an increase of, let's say, 2 degrees Celsius in temperature, the virus that develops in mosquito can be shortened. The dengue virus can be shortened. So in this case, you have more mosquitoes being infected and for a longer period. And when there is dehydration, mosquito will more frequently bite, and this will increase the man-mosquito contact. Here is an example of transmission, which is very important to understand, that you have the dengue is transmitted by human-mosquito-human cycle, and that is the one that maintains this virus in mosquito, the invertebrate, and then the vertebrate hosts the human. So that was how dengue becomes established and become endemic in a particular area. Transmission of dengue. What makes Aedes mosquito becoming a vector? See, in the endemic area, the Aedes mosquito taking the first feed on an infected host who has got virus in the blood. So the mosquito will acquire blood at the same time, taking in the virus. And this virus will go into most parts of the mosquito, including the salivary glands, and it will multiply into very high number of virus. And this multiplication period is called an extrinsic incubation period. It will take a period of about 5 to 7 days. And then this mosquito will take another feed, and it will take a very targeted host, another host, another man. And during this second feed is when the virus will be transmitted to the new person. How the virus is being passed on from person to person. So obviously, this person will have their period of incubation, and then you have virus in the blood, viremia takes place, and other mosquitoes will come and take the virus. The thing that's very important to remember here is that once a mosquito is being infected, it is stays infective for life, which means mosquito can live for 2 to 3 months. So every feed that it takes in, it will be passing that the virus. The dengue control, there are three prongs method. You have disease management, where you have cases have to be detected early and treatment ensures that taking place. You need to strengthen the referral services and you need to have preparedness, epidemic preparedness and rapid response team to be on the lookout. The other method is integrated vector management and supportive interventions. In the integrated vector control here, you have to look at the environmental manipulation modification is key to be able to fight the vector. You have chemical control, you have intersectoral coordination, biological control, the IEC activities and personal protection measures. The environmental modification here, these are lessons and practices which is very important for the public and the community to be involved in, is trying to get rid of all the containers that are potential water collecting cans. So, or if they are either to be buried or you can just turn any containers watering cans, or you can store them under shelter. And in case of, let's say, you have a lot of flower plants with pots and plates, this one has to be, the water has to be removed and clean. And usually, we advise not to avoid to use the plant pot plates if possible. And also, water can collect on hardened soil in the potted plants. So you need to loosen this soil from time to time. And some of these gully traps, which are rarely used, need to be covered and replace these perforated ones and install anti-mosquito valves in them. So mosquito surveillance, the first surveillance actually is the larval stage. Larval stage, you need to inspect houses to look at the percentage of house infected with larva or pupae, and this we call this house index. We have looked also at the containers that hold water infected with larva, that contains larva. These are container index. And also can look at the number of containers which has got larva per 100 houses inspected, this Brutto index, and also pupae index where you can find per 100 houses they are being inspected. So this indexes here, the enable entomologists or control officers to have some idea of the state of dengue, whether that locality has indication of dengue sensitive and therefore measures, protective and preventive measures has to be taken. And about the adult mosquito surveys, which has to be done, collection being made on the biting or landing mosquitoes, or resting mosquitoes collection, and the overposition threats are being being engaged. So these OV traps are actually devices which can be used to detect the presence of Aegypti where the population density is low. So this is quite a very useful method. And usually the OV traps are used when to evaluate the impact of adulticide space spraying on female adult mosquito population. Besides the environmental control, you can spray the mosquito using chemicals. The spraying against the larva, not spraying the larva, actually we can use thermophores in water containing containers which you keep in the house. So this thermophores actually acts as a larvicide. Spraying the adults, we use melatonin, right, through fogging or the ultra-low volume spray. Pyrethrum spray has been used and also some other commercial spray of a certain percentage of pyrethrum diluted with a kerosene. Repellents, this in the form of DEET or dimethyl phthalate, which also is used as a personal protection. Besides that, the form of control can be biological, where typically mosquito larvae can be killed or eaten by some predators like fish. Mosquito fish is very well known, commonly used for as a biological control methods. We have some other insects, larvae, like the huge dragonfly, damselfly in the water. These are aquatic stage of these insects, aquatic beetles, and some aquatic organisms like planaria. And besides this, we can also use bacteria, not specifically for dengue, of course, but these bacteria produce endotoxins. They are being spread into areas which have larvae. Bacillus is a very commonly used bacteria to produce endotoxin as a biological control. Further, we have genetic control in which at the moment, there are a few types of genetic control, but the most commonly used is by the sterile male release technique or the using cytoplasmic incompatibility. These two actually are being used currently when you have the Wolbachia infected mosquitoes being released in the open. So there are limitations for this genetic control where sometimes the released mosquitoes, they lack competitiveness in mating with the wild mosquitoes in the wild area. And sometimes you have introduction of fertile females from other parts. These are close to a release site. So these are limitations that need to be taken, to be noted for genetic control. And finally, control of use through personal protection. We, as we mentioned just now, let's say if you are a dengue person in the hospital or you are staying at home, mosquito net actually is recommended for the patient. This net actually, we have the insecticide treated bed nets with betametrine that will prevent mosquito from biting you, and the mosquito become a potential vector to other person, to their household members. And if your house, you can put screen on the windows and also in the doors of certain diameter so that mosquito won't get in. And of course, the repellent, which I mentioned just now. So it's very important about this control of the vectors of dengue is to behavioral change and campaign. This campaign and has to be repetitive and has to be sustained, a massive campaign. It has to be intense and persistent. It requires an inter-collaboration of community participation and inter-sectoral collaboration. So how we go about doing this? We need to educate the public about all the information about transmission and the vector. So knowledge about the disease is very important. You use the mass media, you can use outdoor publicity, billboards, using microphone that goes along the roadside in residential areas, from rallies, materials in health education be distributed through pamphlets and interpersonal communication. Just a little bit about the genetic control of mosquito. Currently, the Wolbachia infected mosquito being used. We know that Wolbachia is that a type of bacteria that is found in many insects. But in this mosquito, they are not found in the wild of in Aedes mosquito. So what we do, this mosquito is being colonized in the lab and they are being infected, the eggs are being infected with the bacteria, Wolbachia, and they are being released in areas which has been hotspot areas where dengue is there. So the infected Wolbachia mosquito will mate with the wild mosquito and this will block the transmission of the virus. And also, besides blocking transmission of the dengue virus, the result of the mating actually will produce sterile generation. So we have a suppressed number of mosquitoes, or you have wild mosquito is being replaced by the Wolbachia infected Aedes. Some of the area being done now in many states in Malaysia, and they I think so far they have released quite up to 3 million of these mosquitoes and 900,000 eggs of Wolbachia infected Aedes mosquito in various parts of the country. A little bit about dengue vaccine. Dengue vaccine has been used in a few countries, but Malaysia hasn't used it because they need to look at the viability of the fourth stage. Then the other also dengue vaccine in the pipeline. And finally, I just like this is the to drive home the message is that dengue is still a serious problem, even though it has been not so much the news in the past two and a half years. It's important to have early diagnosis and treatment of those cases. We need to stop the spread of the disease by passive and active surveillance. We need to eliminate breeding places of mosquitoes through community effort. And of course, personal protection is very important and health education. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Dr. Johari Surin, by sharing with us the behavior of the mosquito, which is we think that we can live together with the mosquito. But now we have several ways to actually protect ourselves from dengue. We will keep all our questions at the end for the panel discussions. With this, I would like to introduce our third panelist. This is Dr. Siti Aisyah Mokhtar from University Putra, Malaysia. Dr. Siti Aisyah is a medical lecturer and a public health medicine specialist in UPM. Dr. Siti Aisyah has vast experiences in disease surveillance when she was a public health physician with the Ministry of Health disease surveillance sectors. Today, she will be sharing with us on the outbreak management and what Pejabat Kesihatan Daerah do after receiving the notifications. So Dr. Siti Aisyah, the time is yours.
Thank you, Prof. Chi. All right. Let me share my presentation. All right. So good morning, good evening, everyone. So assalamualaikum. So basically, I will recap back what Prof Tan and Prof Johari had mentioned before tentang the clinical diseases and then how this integrated factor management telah dijalankan and then how actually we going to control dengue. So basically, way before we have pandemic, we have COVID. So the most close enemy is dengue. So I'm sure that everyone by now is already quite familiar with dengue and how actually dengue being controlled. So just a little bit recap on what Prof. Johari had mentioned before. So basically, for the outbreak or untuk wabak terjadi, so in any infectious disease, it requires an interactions between agent, which is agents that we refer to is the parasite or the virus itself. And then we have host and then we have environment. So this is what we call it the epidemiological triad. So the first one is the agent, which now we refer to dengue as the dengue virus. We have dengue then type 1, 2, 3, and 4. Whereby setiap satu disease ni, every viruses, the type of virus determines based on their infectivity. So how contagious, how infection they are to transmit from one person to another person, how virulent they are, either they can cause severe complications or death, and how pathogenicity of this virus to cause infection. Then we also have a little bit a difference from other diseases. Kalau kita cakap pasal dengue or when we are talking about vector-borne diseases, they also have a components of vector in our triad. So basically in dengue, we have, I think by now, everyone had aware on the two main vector that cause dengue, which is Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. So what special features about this vector is, you know, we have like a lot of mosquitoes, we have many vectors, but they require a competent vector to transmit the infection, basically the dengue virus. So it depends on the density of the vector, the competency of the vector to bring the virus from one person to another person, and the number of the vector itself, the affected population, whereby later on, I think by now we already knows that, you know, how this mosquito actually breed, where actually they are, and where it actually the density of this mosquito determines. Yeah. And then we have our characteristic, which is our host. So basically, we can say that those who are, you know, high risk group, those who get the infections may got, you know, severe complication, those who are extreme age, those who are less than 5 years, children, babies, and then elderly, or those who had severe comorbidities like uncontrolled diabetic, hypertension, or maybe those who are on under immunosuppressant. So they are the one that are high risk for complications. So even though when we are talking about dengue is endemic, so we have to take cautious that in our community, there are certain people who are vulnerable and susceptible for complications. And then again, our human behavior, which I think we've been touched a little bit, and Prof Chi had mentions on how we're going to promote that kita kena buang sampah dekat dalam tong sampah, how our behavior behave so that we did not provide a suitable environment for the vector to breed. Yeah? And then, of course, the occupational, which that some occupational, they cannot escape from exposing themselves to the environment that's suitable for mosquitoes. And then the last one, which I think this is the most modifiable factor yang boleh kita ubah. So rather than behavior ourselves, and then this is something that we can change. Of course, we cannot change climate. As we mentioned that, you know, there are changes in climate where climate change take place, they increase the survivability of the vector. But again, there are some environmental that we can modify. So for example, that, you know, we did not provide or we destroy the areas that are suitable for breeding. For example, like we destroy those containers that contains water, proper waste management. So, and then of course, in higher level, we think about, you know, a proper town planning. So we know that dengue is mostly an urban problem. So why? Because of all these problems, the solid waste management, improper town planning, whereby, you know, this just take a small number millimeters of water for the egg to hatch to become a larvae. So basically, by having this triad, so any disruptions between these may cause an outbreak. So if the environment had the virus, so for example, that the dengue virus is there in our environment, but if there's no vector or the vector density is very low, then most likely the outbreak will not occur. Or if the vector is there, but we did not provide a conducive environment for them to breed, so the density and the populations of the vector is reduced, so there are small chances of dengue outbreak to be occurred. So by understanding that, then we realize that there are certain factors that we can do to prevent ourselves from getting the disease and prevent the outbreak to occur in our community. So basically, when we are talking about prevention, we always thought that, you know, kita gotong royong, bersihkan rumah. We always thought it is home. But bear in mind, vector or mosquito, it can be present anywhere. So we always tend to forget that our workplace is also had a potential to cause the source of infections, or maybe our nearby playground, recreational park, or, you know, those areas that surrounding us. Because, you know, dengue, they don't bite, you know, when I live in Aisyah house, I bite Aisyah's family. They don't know who are the territories. So the mosquito can, you know, like Prof. Johari mentions, they can fly up to 100 meter radius. So you can imagine that, you know, if we've been surrounded by areas which are susceptible for breeding areas for mosquito to breed, so we also had exposing ourselves to potential infectious dengue disease and outbreak as well. So think, when we are talking about prevention, it's not only prevent and clean our house, our surrounding, our community, our neighborhood, our workplace, so that we minimize our risk to be exposed for this disease. And then how we're going to do it, what I can, you know, see is we can find the breeding area. We could destroy if we found any, and then we can prevent from our surrounding so that they are not suitable for breeding site, and we also can protect ourselves. So by right, when we want to say about finding breeding area, bear in mind that we have to know where actually we want to find it, right? So basically, Aedes mosquito, they breed in the stagnant water, clear stagnant water. So previously, we always thought like the tire, the vest, we always thought something like, you know, very clear. But bear in mind now, every house, they have cuckoo, they have koi, you know, they have like a small water container below that, that it's just small, but we never realized. So when we do what we call it, search and destroy breeding area, we realized that that was one of the main areas that we found mosquito egg or larva. So that is something like you have to think. Another thing is, you know, our dish pelapik rak pinggan, so dish drainer. So even though it's just very flat, but they also have the what we call it area that can retain water there, even just a small water. So imagine that from egg to hatch to into a water, it took about only a few milliliter, so less than 5 milliliter. So it just, you don't require, you know, a whole big pool of water. It just small stagnant water can hatch the egg into a larvae. So another thing is, you know, we can look at you know, our baldi, toilets, and then our gutter. So there are a lot of areas which had a potential for mosquito to breed. So if we know where they are, we can find them. Yeah. So when we can find them, what should we do? The next one is to destroy it. So like Prof. Johari had mentioned before, when the egg attached to the wall of the container, so without the water, the egg can stay in the wall or in dry area up to 8 months. So, you know, we can allow the egg to be there for 8 months. Once you have a small little drops of water, and then it can just hatch the egg into a larvae. And then finally, another 5 more days later, it becomes adult mosquito. So basically what we require is after we found any egg or any larvae, so we have to pour it the water. And then the next one is we need to scrub it, because remember, the egg, when they attach the wall, is like a glue. So it's very, you know, very attached to the wall. So we need to scrub it thoroughly so that we want to ensure that the egg did not stick to the water, to the wall. So then we want to ensure that, you know, this container did not contain any more egg, mosquito egg. Yeah. So not only pour the water, but scrub the container. And then the next one is, if we found, we already destroyed, but bear in mind, we also have to prevent the areas from providing an environment for breeding. So always keep the water storage tank covered securely. So there are areas that we always found, especially when we are doing our search and destroy, we always found that, you know, even sometimes you close your water storage tank, but it was not properly, just small millimeter inches of gap can also introduce into cause a breeding area for the mosquito. Then another thing is that you have to dispose the garbage properly. So of course, we've been seeing that areas that had this illegal garbage disposal area or waste management or improper waste management by local authorities, or we throw ourselves, throw garbage ourselves to, you know, to the drain, did not discard garbage properly, did not tie it properly. So those are the areas that can had a potential to cause and breeding area, especially during the rainy season. Okay, and then if you require to have open water storage, so for example, like in your aquarium, so or maybe your a vase that you require to have a water for your flower, then use larvicide. So larvicide, you can, you know, like a bit, then you can put that and then regularly change the water. And then the one of the commonest that we found also is from the leaking pipe, or maybe from the building defects from your house. So sometimes you found any defect, which it can contribute to the small, small stagnant water to be there, which is also contribute to the breeding area. So whenever you found a defect, try to maintain it and make sure that it did not contain the water. So just a simple step, but it's very, sometimes the behavior, because we always pakisa, so that's why the dengue can't be disappeared. And then finally is to protect. So once we already prevent our environment, we minimize the risk of our environment to have a mosquito breeding area, and then we protect ourselves. So make sure that if possible, wear a long sleeve, light colored clothes, especially when you are in hotspots area or maybe an outbreak area. So this is, you know, minimize your risk to be bitten by the mosquitoes, and then wear mosquito repellents or insecticide spray so that you reduce your contact with the mosquitoes. And then finally, if you are not well, seek the treatment. So the aim is not only to prevent, for example, that if you are unfortunate to get dengue or being bit by the mosquito, early treatment and early diagnosis could be done. So if any complications, it can be intervened early. So it just find, destroy, prevent, and protect yourself. So it's just simple, but it needs to be practiced and it needs to be consistent. So when we are talking about outbreak, it was unfortunate that, especially in Klang Valley areas and Selangor, we can see that there are multiple areas with the hotspots and outbreak area. So sometimes we may be unfortunate that we got dengue. So what we need to do is, in public health perspective, dengue is one of the mandatory notifiable diseases. So means that if you are seeing a doctor, and then you feed to the clinical symptoms of dengue. So, and if the clinic did have test you with rapid tests for dengue, the doctor that's seeing the patients are mandatory to notify dengue to the nearest district health office within 24 hours. This is to ensure that every dengue cases will be able to notify and then verify and investigate, because the main thing of this disease notifications is we want to look at the environment. So are they contents of breeding, and we want to prevent further outbreak. So once the dengue had been notified to the district health office, so usually we'll do a verification process. So sometimes when you got dengue and then the doctor say, okay, your symptom is mild, please go back and then watch out with your symptoms, and then you require to come back with blood taking. At the same time, you also realize that the Ministry of Health will call you, so from the nearest district office, and then they want to proceed with after notifications. We have a process, what we call it, a verifications. So this is to ensure that your address, what would be the source of infection. So we want to determine the place of infections. So basically the verification will take place, and then we will proceed with the investigation. So all this process is required to ensure that we be able to identify where actually the possible locations the source of infection. So sometimes the source of infection is not from your house. So it could be from your, workplace, or maybe some place that you went within the incubation period. So sometimes the Ministry of Health staff will call you and will ask your movement history. So they will ask you, where did you work for the past 7 days? Where did you have gone? Then that is some of the information that they require to have an brief idea or initial idea where actually the source of infection. Next one, once the investigation had been conducted, then they will provide or they will conduct a field survey. So the first one will be search and destroy. So we'll go to the what we call it, the potential source of infectious locations. Then we look for the breeding area. So basically, we are looking at the high risk areas that we are mentioned before that may contain water container or stagnant water. Then after that, we do larval sightings, and then at evening they will provide or they will conduct fogging. But again, bear in mind, so larval sighting is to kill the larva, and then the fogging is to kill the adult mosquito. For examples, like if you coming back from, or the source of infection is from the hotspots area or the outbreak area, whereby fogging had been done 3 days before. So usually they will not proceed with fogging. So it really depends on how, when is the last time that area or that locality were conducted fogging. So, and again, to do a fogging basically is to kill adult mosquito. So if we did not do larva sighting and we did not destroy the breeding area, bear in mind, after fogging, the larva in it is still there. So there will be another new batch of mosquito after 5 days. So basically, it's required to have search and destroy of breeding area, larva sighting, and then fogging. At the same time, Ministry of Health also do this ultra ULV. Sorry. So this is something like a fogging also, but they are using ultra light volumes fog. So they will be fogging surrounding the house. So what you need to do is, during this process, the cooperation from the community is very important. So in the outbreak area, so our health inspector, they will use the Destructions of Disease Bearing Act 1975. So this is under the act whereby they have to look for any potential disease breeding area. So they will look at search and control, provide a larval sighting and fogging. So we require cooperation from the community, whereby if the Ministry of Health come, then you provide, you know, you assist them on this activity, especially when you are doing the search and control, and then when you are doing a fogging area. So sometimes the search and control is not only contained at the what we call it, the case house, but we will expand the radius within the 100 meters. Remember that the mosquito did not know the territory, so we have to expand the areas of search and destroy, and then we do a fogging. So what we need to do is, when the Ministry of Health required to do fogging, so basically they will make an announcement that they will conduct a fogging this evening. So basically what you need to do is, you have to open your door, and then you have to move out. So especially those who had respiratory problems, so it may alter your it may cause more respiratory symptoms. Then you must ensure that, you know, every doors in the in the house to be open, so that this fog with the the poisons went and get into your house and kill the adult mosquitoes who lays maybe behind your curtain or in your room. So, and then cover the food, make sure that if you are cooking, you cover the food, and also you switch off the fire first. So This is something very basic, but what we always see is, you know, when people doing fogging, what you do is, you know, the community tends to close the door, and then the fog will not get into the house. So basically, just fogging outside the area instead of inside the house. So and Ministry of Health also, they conducted endological survey. This is what I think Prof. Johari had mentioned, and at the same time, they want to see either the what we call the drugs is also that did not resist, the mosquito is not resistant to the drugs as well. So this is to ensure that the effectiveness of preventions and control of the outbreak is achieved. And then finally, in Ministry of Health, they also monitored what we call it, the disease surveillance. So disease surveillance is defined as ongoing systematic collection. So basically, they collect data, they look at the trend of the disease, where are the hotspots area, where are the outbreak area, where are the controlled outbreak area, uncontrolled outbreak areas, and basically they analyze to look at the trend, where are the potential hotspots area, and it also can be done to predict the areas. Of course, when we are talking about dengue, also there are also multiple confounding factors, multiple variables that may contribute to the outbreak as well. So this is very simple, that how you can know that your area is hotspot or control outbreak or uncontrolled outbreak. You can go to this iDengue. This is for the committee, and they updated where are actually the areas of the hotspots or outbreak area, so that you know that I'm coming back from hotspots area. So when you have a fever, there are potentials that you may contract with the disease. So, you know, it gives you more kesedaran, so the potential disease or infections that you have. And they also, Ministry of Health, they also updated inside the MySejahtera. So when you go to into MySejahtera, you also be able to see what is the latest disease being notified within your house areas or your location. So this is important so that you aware of your surrounding, and then you'll be able to take appropriate measures and prevent yourself from getting the infections. So basically, that is, you know, the basic dengue preventions and control for dengue and the outbreak. So basically, we have to find, destroy, prevent, and protect ourselves from getting dengue. That's all. Thank you, Prof. Chi.
Thank you, Aisa, for sharing with us about the how we as the human, okay, to change our behavior and to actually destroy, find first, we have to find and start to destroy the breeding site for the mosquito. Okay, now we would like to have our panel discussions with all our three panels, and I already collected a few questions. The first questions we'd like to give to Dr. Tan. Yeah? Dr. Tan, you mentioned about the diarrhea. It become one of the, put it that way, maybe a new symptoms, sign and symptoms for dengue, whether it's related to age or not.
Basically, there's no related to age. It's just that if it's younger who have diarrhea, more frequent diarrhea, it will be more dangerous compared with the the middle age lah. But for the elderly also, if the elderly who have more diarrhea, definitely they will be easily get dehydrated and also get severe disease. So extreme ages will be more dangerous compared with those who are between the healthy young group lah, huh? So other than that, there's no like if you get dengue in younger child will have more diarrhea, or in the adult will have less diarrhea. That one I don't have any data to support this. Yeah.
So Dr. Tan, if let's say a mother's looking at the kids is having diarrhea, afraid of dehydration. So what the mother or the parents can do before quickly rush the kids to the emergency department?
Okay, I think a worried mother and father, I should know that a child with fever, usually they will have some diarrhea somehow, because this is the way how they get rid of the fever from the body. right? So if the child had one time or two times of diarrhea, but or they still can take orally well, means that they can at least drinking the milk or drinking some water, then they are not too worried about. But however, if the child start to not taking orally at all, no food, even cannot drink any milk or water, means that they are already three to 4 hours, they're not taking anything in orally. So I think you should bring to the hospital. Maybe we need to give a drip and then we'll see what's going on with this child. Yeah. So if one time diarrhea, two time diarrhea, patient can eat, can running around, or even though they are sleeping for a while, sleeping, but they're still like a bit weak, but it's still like a manageable, then you don't need to bring to hospital.
So don't jam the emergency department, Dr. Tan.
But if you're still very worried, you can go to GP first and have a look and to assess first. Mm-hmm. If let's say you are not really sure that you are doing the right thing or not, just bring to any GP would do. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. For our title, we're talking about the COVID-19. Mm. So during the past 2 years, have you seen any co-infections, meaning that COVID and also dengue in the emergency department? Now, I'm very curious about the how you manage this kind of patients in the emergency department.
The COVID that mimic dengue, we had some cases like that. But to have both co-infection in my hand, I don't think so. I have managed one. I don't know why they're so special about COVID. There's no I didn't see any co-infection in my case. But in Singapore, I think there is case COVID with dengue. They reported a case report. However, I just forgot the details, but definitely double infection definitely will give you more headache, right? More infection, more inflammation. More inflammation, patient will be ill. And then the synergism of these two infection, would that give you a worse effect? Yet I don't have data to tell you. For my personal experience, I didn't have any experience on these two. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I come to the detection. So usually when a patient rush to the emergency department, what the doctor will do in the emergency department?
Quite simple. Usually they will triage you first in the emergency department. Triage means they sort you out whether you are dangerous or you are in a very light disease. Okay. A lot of public complain. I'm having dengue. Why I have to wait for 3 to 4 hours, maybe 5 hours waiting to see the doctor in the emergency department. First of all, emergency department is for emergency cases. We would think that the dengue is emergency cases. Actually, dengue is not as dangerous as you think. Because it usually come in late. Only we feel that the dengue is dangerous, but majority of dengue is self-limiting, meaning that you can really manage at home. Not necessarily all the people who have dengue have to come to hospital. Somehow, some people just get dengue, they don't know, and then they heal already, and then they cure. So first of all, don't panic when you hear about getting a dengue. Once you come to hospital, we will sort it out according to your vital sign, meaning that we check your blood pressure, we check your heart rate, we check your temperature. For those who are having a temperature of 40 degrees and above, definitely we will directly see the patient in the we call it semi-critical zone. Or you have all the warning signs that just now we mentioned about diarrhea non-stop, abdominal pain, you have a very lethargic, meaning that sangat penat, malaise, or you're bleeding now, you know, then we will immediately see you. If you are like an early fever, like a fever of like 39, 38 degrees, we'll put you in a non-critical zone, which is like an outpatient, but yet it's inpatient, we will see you a bit later, which is according to the priority of the disease. Once you was admitted, if you are critical, definitely critical, we will go into, we set you a line, get some blood tests, and then we'll put you on drip. Definitely we will let you, we will check your all the blood tests, whether you are fit to, you need to admit or not, or you can discharge with advice, or you actually need transfusion, or you need some, then we will allow you, we will tell you what to do next. usually we will let you eat, eat and then force you to drink a lot of water. Then you see a lot of people will buy a lot of isotonic, put beside of the table. We will put you in observation ward and let you drink, and then we'll chart your drinking every hour to 2 hours. Okay, how much you drink, how much you urinate out. So you have to chart in your chart, you know. The patient have to do their own homework in the hospital. So we will monitor you in the observation ward or in the general medical ward, depend. Or ICU, if you are very critically ill, meaning that you need a resuscitation, meaning that you need to put in blood, you need to put a lot of fluid. Those will be in ICU. So you have three scenarios. And the fourth scenario is that you come in, doctor said you are quite well, then we give you a chart, you go back home and chart this thing up, and then you just go to the nearest clinic to repeat blood every day. That's the fourth scenario, you go back home. So this is the fourth scenario usually you will end up into.
Roughly so, thank you, Dr. Tan. I hope all our participants are clear. If let's say you already diagnosed to have dengue, but it's mild, and then doctor send you back home asking you to come back into the clinic kesehatan for a blood testing, please, you need to come every day. Yeah,
you need to come. Don't miss it. You know, you say this is not dangerous, so doctor say can go back. Then you're at home, and then they feel better already. No more fever, and then you don't need to come to the hospital. No, when you got dengue, when you get better, this is the dangerous time that the dengue will kill you if you didn't note any sign or symptom that is subtle.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I hope our participants, and also you can share the information that you know from today's webinar with your friends and family members. That is very important to understand this, and so that you can save life. Yeah, save your own life or save your loved one. So now I want to address the questions to Dr. Aisyah. In your presentation, you talk about dengue virus in four different serotypes. So is this means that when I got the first infection, for example, with dengue 2, am I protective towards dengue 1, dengue 3, and dengue 4?
Thank you, Prof. Chi, and thank you for asking the question. So yes, you may have, if you got dengue 1, then you may also have potential to get dengue 2, dengue 3, and dengue 4. So you are not protecting for the whole dengue virus. So that's why we always see notifications that those who've been notified dengue, I think last 6 months, and then they've also been notified again with dengue, and we still accept the notifications because the potentials of they might get the new what the other types of dengue virus.
So meaning that in Malaysian, since dengue is endemic in Malaysia, so Malaysians have the potential to come down with four types of dengue infection.
Yes, correct, Prof. Chi. And I believe that there are, in some literatures, they mentions that if they are crossed, for example, so that they have been protected from one, what we call it, dengue virus. So if you got another strain, which they can cross infections between those two, so that's why the severity getting more. So usually the second or the third time will be worse than the first one. So that's why they are still gray areas. So we require, you know, it's very difficult that everyone had dengue. We have to run the serology and to find and detect dengue virus. So they, if you got, you know, second time, third time, there are potentials for you to get more worse symptoms and may also lead to complications.
Yeah, so this meaning that it's a secondary infection which will be more potential to be more severe. So for the audience, if you think that last 6 months you got one time with the come down with dengue, and then now second time you come down with dengue, you say okay, I maybe have the immune protections, but it's not right. There's a potential to have a severe. So in maybe Dr. Tan, can you share with us, have you seen this kind of a condition, the secondary infection, which is worsened situations? You are muted.
Okay. Yeah. Actually, quite common that we've seen the second time dengue, but not as many patients who have second time dengue must be in danger or in a severe form, but most of them, there is a chances that they will advance into a severe dengue. meaning like dengue in dangerous dengue lah. However, usually when the patient come in, we will ask this question: have you been infected before? Have you got dengue before? And then also we will ask about how far ago you had this dengue. But majority of our friends or our patient won't remember unless they have been admitted or being frequently daily taken blood tests. But we will have highly suspicious of this. Usually we'll see we'll look into the serology. The serology that IgM, IgG will give us somehow some idea on whether they are secondary or they are primary. However, we don't have the immediate result in our hand. Usually the dengue test result, you can get on the same day. Mm-hmm. But we have rapid test kit. We have rapid test kit, which you can immediately confirm that when you come in, we just take the blood and drop onto the test kit. We immediately can get the result whether you are dengue or not. However, there's a lot of pitfall. These are rapid tests. They can give you a false negative. It means that it doesn't mean that a negative is must be no dengue. We have to wait for the formal result from the blood test in the lab. Because the title is different, right? So this is how we look into the secondary dengue. Lah. We also seen secondary dengue pass away. Recently, last week only, I have one patient who are foreigner because they didn't know that he had a dengue, and then he came very late. When he come in already, assisted, means that he already succumbed to that. But we managed to CPR him and get him back, but he still cannot. He succumbed to that also. Because we know that dengue is reversible, we can treat the patient. So if let's say you know that you have dengue before and then you come in with a suspect dengue, definitely should come earlier lah. Don't keep at the homes, tunggu lama-lama and then get worse only come to hospital. Too late. We can't do much.
Okay. So it's so sad to hear that actually dengue is treatable disease and then it's due to the we are not aware about it. So when you talk about the rapid test kit, actually because one of your research interests is point of care test, right?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, since now we have a lot of RTK antigen for SARS-CoV-2 cell test, so do you see that in the future whether this dengue can become a rapid test kit, can become a cell test first? Meaning that I may not be a doctor, so I do not know about the sign and symptom and how to check the warning sign, for example. Maybe I suspect that could be a dengue. I just do a cell test just to test that whether I have dengue or not.
Okay, this is quite tricky to do a cell test at home using a blood test. But it is possible because of the COVID has majorly trained us to know what is RTK. The word RTK is being famous, right, during this our pandemic time. I myself also reinvented a sepsis rapid test kit, which is also similar with the dengue test kit. We foresee that our public here can really do it. You know, like you do a glucometer. I think glucometer have been very long time reinvented, right? And a lot of people can do their own with one drop of fingers. Run the blood from fingers, you can test the blood test. So I think if the manufacturer on the RTK for dengue, a rapid test for dengue, can be user-friendly, definitely they have to invent this and then they can go for public. But you just give them a red light, a green light, or one light, two light, like that is better. Don't give them all this complicated IgM, IgG, NS1. They will confuse.
Yes. Your testing, one line is negative, two line is positive, so straight.
Yeah, but it's hard, you know, it's hard to tell because NS1 is different day, you know, IgM is different day, IgG is different day. So you have to find one very good one for the public.
Yeah, when you're having a fever, you just do a test.
I think NS1 will be do only enough. Satu cukup lah, satu.
I think Prof Chi, maybe I add a little bit on this rapid test. Actually, it's similar like COVID when we have rapid tests for the public, right? Yeah. So for us, especially in public health, so dengue is a matter of clinical management. But at the same time, when they noted themselves to have dengue, they have to notify, because if not, you will have, you know, the outbreak will be contained at the later stage. So that was the dilemma, you know. when we want to see what would be the benefit for, with the risk. So we have to look, because one thing is we protect ourselves, but we forget that we want to protect our community from the outbreak as well. So when you have dengue, there are potentials that maybe two or three people in our neighborhood might have dengue as well. So so it comes with package that if you be able to do your rapid test, you'll be able also to assess and notify the information to the authorities, so that the preventions and control of the breeding area could be done faster.
I totally agree with Dr. Siti Aisha. Maybe Prof. Jari want to talk something about it.
Perhaps I could just keep in here. The other thing about the, even to do run a rapid serological test on dengue, there might be some cross-reaction against other virus like Zika, chikungunya, and other virus, flavi virus, JE and all those. So the fact that COVID has got this rapid test because of the emergency and the urgency that we need to have a good grip on COVID. But for dengue, we are talking about dengue with warning signs and severe dengue. So I think there are categories there. So I think if you have got an excellent rapid test with a very good sensitivity and specificity, then probably I think that can go on. And as what Dr. Tan mentioned about the glucometer type, or even some of the tests here, we can get the skin or the saliva or the sweat, advanced tests. That probably, I think, in the future can be thought out.
When Dr. Aisa talking about this one reporting, now with the mice, et cetera, because we everyone knows when you are doing the COVID-19 RTK cell test, if you are positive, you have to upload your
remember report.
So that could be another way of enforcing that the public to upload. So it's like some sort of like notifications of that lah. But education is always very important in this case. When you talk about the detection, I want to ask Dr. Johari about possibles that a mosquito carry more than one serotype, and then when they bite and they transmit the two different serotypes into the human.
That is very interesting. Good question, Dr. Chi. Mm-hmm. I haven't come across about thorough research about having more than one serotype, but it's not not impossible to have a particular individual mosquito that can carry more than one serotype, because mosquito lifespan is three months.
Mm-hmm.
The season where you have the let's say then one is on, it goes for a while and probably will be taken by then too. So there's possibility that the mosquito can harbor and become vector of two serotype, which is quite dangerous, because as mentioned just now, if you get the first then one and followed by then two with a antibody enhancement phenomena, so it can be quite detrimental to the patient. But I think this is quite rare. I think the chance of Aedes vector harboring two serotypes concurrently is quite a rare occasion, which you know we have to be glad for that.
But clinically we had patients with two DEN together, in fact in one patient lah. We had this type of experience, DEN 1 and DEN 3, or DEN 1 and DEN 2 together. We had this together. Yeah. So maybe it's the same mosquito or different type of mosquito, two type of mosquito bite him together. I don't know.
It could be as what Dr. Johari mentions, that the mosquito is the what feeder, the the words when you are talking about the they will bite and then after that they will fly away and then they will find another
nervous. They are nervous feeder. Mosquito get infected for lifetime.
Oh, okay.
So lifespan, depending on the humidity and temperature. So it is mosquito, usually they don't have this what you call symbionts called Wolbachia like other mosquito, but if supposing they have got enough number of this area, they might block transmission of these various dengue strain, which is very exciting thing for people to look into these various serotypes which can be found in a particular time or particular season.
Mm-hmm. So another thing is I know mosquito, it can fly about 100 meters. So now in KL or this one, we have all a lot of high-rise building. I even heard about, say, oh, I'm staying in the 14th floor, 15th floor. There's no mosquito will fly that high. So I no need to worry. So I have my vase with all the water. I have all the cup with the water. So is it true? Maybe I pass it to Dr. Siti Aisa, since you are in the disease surveillance sector before.
So thank you, Prof. Chi. It's something like very common. People thought that if I live in, level 16, 15, so the mosquito will be not around. So, which is previously was true, but now it is not. So the mosquito getting clever, so they can use, sometimes it was surprised that you found breeding area inside the leaf itself, because there are rubbish or garbage inside the leaf. So, and the mosquito can go up. So basically, they can also cause infections in high-rise breeding. So basically, when we do foggings, in Ministry of Health, when they are doing fogging, so we will go and find exactly where are actually the levels, and then the fogging will be going up and down. So it doesn't mean that you are living higher up, you are protected from dengue. So, and of course, there are certain levels that when we are talking about, let's say you are living in condominiums up where in uphills, the potential could be very much more lesser. But if you're talking about KL, the humidity, the temperature is very stable. So even you are living at 13th floor, so you are still provide an environment and climate for the mosquito to breed. So it did not protect you from getting infections.
So not necessary saying that you are living so dekat bawah tu mungkin senang dapat gigitan nyamuk. Saya pindah rumah. Saya pindah rumah kepada
high-rise. Oh, orang kayangan kena juga gigit.
Nak tanya, I got a question for this. You see, cold weather, less mosquito bite. Then you stay in house with aircon on. On aircon, do you reduce the mosquito transmission on dengue? This is first question. The second question is that just now I want to answer to Dr. Sitaisha is that if the rapid test kit, if your tech, meaning that nowadays we invented something like a rapid test kit can geotag the location of where you do the testing. So definitely you sort your notification problem. We have this geotag technology now.
Yeah,
so the first question. Aircon boleh kurangkan tak dengue transmission?
Dengue transmission, but yet kan, when we are talking about aircon, so let's say we took our neighbor countries, which is Singapore, they are like so much aircon, we went out also air conditioning. But again, because we are tropical countries, and even we are, running our aircon, it's still within a range of suitable for the egg to hatch into a larva. So basically, it did not accept that you, maybe I was wondering that maybe the temperature in Cameron Highlands or Genting Highlands could be maybe a bit different. But again, if you are talking about urban areas, there are urban heat, which also contribute. So using air conditioning did not much changes in the range of the mosquito to breed. So I would say that it was not, except that if you're using air conditioning and you did not have breeding areas, that was the keyword. So if you did not have the breeding area, then I think we are safe and being protected. So another question is on geotab. Actually, it was very interesting, Prof Tan, because now, since COVID, people start looking at this digital health that is very, very, very much more useful. So I remember that when I'm working in Ministry of Health, at initial part, notification still in data analysis in manual process, but if the number of cases getting bigger, we are dealing with bigger data, and then this digital health, this machine learning, they are very much helpful for us in terms of either health in clinical. So I really foresee that this is the way forward for us to utilize the digital in managing, preventing, and controlling infectious diseases.
Yeah, so that is, or maybe Johari, Dr. Johari, you would like to add in about the aircon?
Yeah, I do agree with Dr. Asia regarding the effect of aircon on the intensity of mosquitoes. See, aircon actually being put on during, let's say, daytime. I'm talking about daytime mosquito because it is a daytime biters. And Aedes can survive from 16 degrees Celsius to 30 or slightly above 30. So you're going to put your aircon, the lowest I could put my aircon is really 16. Just below 20. So at 16, they can still survive and they can still survive and live. So I think aircon for tropical countries might not work in terms of reducing the numbers. And you still have breeding. Your house, if you've got breeding sites, you can still have Aedes mosquito breeding inside the house. I think only the severe winter will reduce mosquito. And mind you, actually, mosquito, when it's too cold, or they have what you call overwintering or diapause. And I'm talking about the adults as well as the eggs. So when the conditions are suitable, they will, get out from the dormant and survive again. So Aedes has really evolved and adapt to conditions in a very, very fantastic fashion.
Yeah, very clever. So we have two questions in the chat. First is the why dengue we are not using the R0 to in terms of effective reproductions indicator. So whether I think Siti, Dr. Siti Asa, you would like to answer these questions?
Okay, so when we are talking about R0, we start to use this R0 when we know COVID, but R0 is something that we use for infectious diseases, but mainly R0 is referring to the contact to get infected. So it's really depend on the infectious period, so durations and how contagious the virus or the disease itself. So when we are talking about dengue, the factor when we remember that our triad just now, so the main concern is the breeding. So the mosquito, the environmental modifications and the vector itself rather than the disease and the host. So basically when we are talking about the contact can infect another person is a bit trickier. So basically, when we are talking about SIR model, they are having two, which is the deterministic and the stochastic effect. So basically, this introduces the dynamic of the model to cause to come up with the R0. So when we are talking about that, so we have to make a lot of assumption to derive the R0. So when we make an assumptions, it can alter the predictions. So somehow the R0 were not really that suitable for cases of vector-borne diseases, but compared to A-borne diseases like COVID, much more easier. One person, in fact, if they see 10 people and then we know that 2 out of 10 are being infected. So it's much more easier to identify and understand the durations of infections. But again, this vector-borne is a bit trickier because they have another component in their transmissions.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Asha.
Yeah. Could I just mention a little bit on that one?
Yeah.
That's what Dr. Asha has mentioned. The complexity of R0 is there. For COVID, it's only man-to-man. Mm. Only two elements beside the other factors of human behavior and all those. But when you have an intermediate host which is involved, like a mosquito, it becomes more complicated. Actually, the R0, the mathematical model was first introduced for malaria many years back by Professor Russell, I believe, and the McDonald, sorry, by my John McDonald, and the mathematical equation is very complicated, and they need to know the bacterial capacity and many other indexes that it has been to put in, and they are very variable. So for malaria, eradication program, the R0 reproductive index 0 actually was not much applied. So they learned from this, like any other vector-borne diseases also is not really practical in theory. Yes, if you have got good very talented mathematician, you can do that. But I think in practice, it might not be quite useful and accurate to predict.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for Dr. Asa and also Dr. Jahari on explaining about the R-naught, the suitability of applying R-naught in what kind of infectious diseases. Yeah. So the second question, may I know the dengue testing management for dengue? Dr. Tan?
Testing management for dengue?
Testing management, meaning that first you suspect what you should test. Test F1, IgG or IgM, something like that.
Means that how we interpret the result or when we want to test.
The dengue testing management means that
the protocol, right?
One you suspected dengue, what are the tests you will do?
Right. Okay, usually what we suspect is by screening your symptom first. Like you have to fulfill the WHO definition of our dengue disease. You should have a 3 day and above fever, and then you see all the signs and symptoms, like just now I mentioned the long list. After, if you have, and then you will ask also, are you from the endemic area? Definitely all Malaysian is endemic area hotspot. So these two criteria fulfilled already, then we will send a serology. So serology depends on each hospital, but usually we will count from day, how many day you fever. If you are the first 5 days of the fever, usually we will send NS1, IgM and IgG. However, if you come at day 6 and 7 above, usually we only send the IgM and IgG only, meaning that for the serology only, without sending the viral vectors serology. That's because of the nature of the disease itself. But then immediately we will know the result. Either is 24 hours, within 24 hours, we'll definitely need to notify. Even though you send the result, send the blood without the result, you already have to notify our inspector kesehatan. If not, Aisha will come and kill me and chase after me. So the notification can be e-notification that's on the system that we need to notify. Or if public, I'm sure just now you said my suggestion, I need to notify later on, maybe. Okay, but for us, be simple, we notify e-notification no matter what type of result is there. Then we'll manage accordingly as a suspect dengue until proven otherwise. Means that all the management have to along with the dengue protocol. That's all. So if you are negative, even we have a rapid test kit, we have a rapid test kit of dengue in our department. Not every hospital other. So this one you also can do it. If this is positive, immediately we can label as dengue first until the serology come up. But I think our IK will like to use the serology. They don't allow the RTK to be as an official result. If it's RTK negative also, we don't discharge. We will still, if we want to discharge the patient, we still have to call back the patient if it's dengue positive from the serology. So we will send two, rapid test kit plus the serology formal one. But we will manage along the case without the result. Means that we will manage as a dengue until proven otherwise it's not. Yeah.
So meaning in this case, nowadays, NS1, they are not taking it as a positive, confirmative?
No. If you use rapid test kit, you can treat as the dengue first. But I think our KKM still want a formal result from the blood test result. They don't want the rapid test kit as the final result. For us, doctor, we as long as we suspect this dengue, no matter what kind of result, not yet out, sudah keluar ke, kecuali the IgG, IgM part, we will manage as the dengue until proven that this is not dengue. Sometimes we repeat 2 times, serology. Sometimes we feel that this is not dengue, but the result comes as dengue, so we repeat 1 more time to make sure that it is confirmed this result is correct or not. So we still have to use a lot of clinical judgment on this, even though the result are positive. Yeah, sometimes there's a mixture of other diseases like Zika, all these things can catch out the result that make us very difficult. This is how the protocol is.
So then there's another question on Wolbachia. So Dr. Johari, you are sharing about the Wolbachia. So I just read a news from Singapore Twitter. So they say that Singapore has successfully implemented the Wolbachia to reduce this one. Perhaps Dr. Johari, you can explain to us the difference between, I think Malaysia also doing the Wolbachia, release the Wolbachia to test? And then what is the difference between Singapore and Malaysia? Since Singapore have raised the case so high for this small country, yeah, 11,000 compared to Malaysia, a big country, we have 13,000 of cases.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. G. Regarding the Wolbachia, which is found in the, which has been infected Aedes mosquitoes, these are colonized ones. There are two, see, in the world there, the most of the Aedes haven't got Wolbachia. So they are good transmitters of the virus. The Wolbachia actually block transmission of virus, of dengue virus, and they also have other effect on the mosquito. So what we do, let's say in Malaysia, they will release the male and female Aedes infected Wolbachia. So this, with the hope that the male, when they mate with a wild female, the generation is degenerate, meaning they don't produce any. So that means this is reduced in numbers. So that is what I call suppression approach.
Mm-hmm.
Also release the female infected Wolbachia, and this female will, they are more, they be able to replace the wild female Aedes. So in Singapore, because it's a smaller area, they take the suppression approach. They reduce the numbers. That means they only release the male infected Wolbachia, the male infected Wolbachia Aedes mosquito. In Malaysia, we release both the male and female. So our approach is both population replacement and suppression of numbers of the natural wild mosquitoes. So there's a difference. Why we don't go for suppression, reduction in numbers? Because Malaysia, the area is too vast. So that's why we have to have two approaches. So actually at the moment now, usually they release about 2,000 over, what you call release this Wolbachia infected mosquitoes in an area, let's say half the size of a football field, for example. So, and then they keep releasing it for over a couple of weeks in all those hotspot areas. And then after that, of course, we have to go and see surveillance and see what is the effect of the dengue. And research has shown that in other countries, like in India and in Brazil, that this is quite an effective way. I think the Wolbachia release technique will gain momentum, and it might be a fairly more effective and a mainstream way of controlling the dengue vector.
Yeah, we can see that currently the highest numbers of dengue cases is in Brazil. So that's why it's not surprising that the Brazil is also employing the Wolbachia infected dengue for their biological control. Okay, now a hot topic now, talking about vaccine. Okay, dengue has been known by humans for more than 100 years ago. Okay, but why currently Malaysia still have not approved a dengue vaccine? So anyone would like to give your thought?
from a doctor point of view, there's some data from Thailand as well. We found that whoever have dengue vaccine, they will have this secondary, once they get the dengue infection, it seems like they will have a secondary dengue infection type of situation. So we call it as AD effects. AD effects is antibody dependence effect. So this is quite rare compared with COVID. COVID is different. COVID is totally don't have this type of effect that make us a bit troubles to sort when they have this injection. Then we have a first time dengue kena, already bad situation. So we need more data actually. Yeah, this is what.
There's two what Dr. Tan is mentioned. Actually, dengue vaccine, which is now in the market.
The market.
It's used specifically for those 9 up to 16 years old, the youngsters, who have not had dengue before. If you have got dengue, before and you introduce this vaccine, you might have a fairly strong adverse reaction. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why dengue is specifically for dengue vaccine, they recommend from 9 to 46 years old. But if you have got dengue before, it might be a bit of a problem. That's why the Sanofi Pasteur dengue vaccine now is having a bit of problem even in Brazil. In Philippines, we know the story. They introduced it to young children and there are a few fatalities, so it frightened the public. So Malaysia now, I was told, they are still holding on until the first stage test is being approved by the authorities.
The clinical trials, you're right.
A little bit more on what Prof. Johari mentions on dengue vaccine. And again, I think this is based on my personal opinions on the reservations of when we are looking at the risk outweigh the benefit. So again, not every diseases we have vaccine. So mostly if we see is more like the airborne disease, the transmission is very, uncontrollable. And then we are looking at the mortality, the virulence of the disease. So if you see, we have like 13,000 cases of dengue, for example, but the number of mortality is still there, but not comparable with, like COVID or maybe like measles or smallpox last time. So it's the infectivity and the virulence of the virus itself. So now when we are talking about dengue, the main component is the vector-borne diseases. So there are still ways that how we're going to minimize our populations to be contracted with the disease while we are waiting for a positive result from the clinical trial. So I think by holding our reservations for this, waiting for a positive result on dengue vaccine, I think this is the most appropriate actions that we can take until we have a promising result on dengue vaccine.
Okay, so that is one question asking about the testing. Dengue fever, if let's say they want to check the dengue fever in clinic with one drop of blood here during the first day of fever, or it must wait. For example, now you're having fever, today you have fever, just like COVID, you have not feeling well. Do you want to test or not right now? Or you let the symptom getting worse, then only you start testing. How about for dengue?
As a doctor perspective, actually day one, day two are really good enough to do the NS1 test only. Other than that, you don't get the other result. NS1 means that you test the antigen in the body. But we will advise, usually we will advise you to do at day two and day three. Why? Because not yet fulfilled the dengue criteria yet, meaning that you haven't had 3 days of fever. So that's why if you want to do self-screening, it's good because if you can early detect, definitely we can prevent you from transmit more. But because of our hospital, the limitation is that you have to come to hospital to test the dengue test. So to fulfill the criteria of WHO, this is the chicken and egg things lah. But good suggestion is that if you can do it day one, day two, if you get a positive result, you can get the positive result by day one, day two. Definitely you can. But the policy wise, we have to improvise, and the definition we have to improvise.
Yeah, so that means you suspect, you can just quickly go to the clinic and then request rapid NS1 test lah, just like our SARS-CoV-2 self-test kit to test it. The antigen, not to test the antibody, because antibody, it will take 5 to 7 days to develop.
Yeah.
Only you will have the antibody. So, and another question that I always heard, school, because Dr. Siti Aisyah tadi mungkin tak cakap sekolah, cakap working the workplace, rumah. Setahu saya, sekolah could be one of the breeding site, especially the toilet bowl. Ini saya nak cakap lah, nak tanya. Toilet bowl, kalau masa cuti sekolah, especially when you have school holiday, end the school holiday, 1 bulan lebih, lama tak guna, tak flush. So whether that could be a breeding site or not?
Thank you, Prof. Chi. Yeah, that is another place that we always forget, the school, especially Cuti Sekolah. So before the Cuti Sekolah and after, I mean, throughout the Cuti Sekolah also, the hospital, the school management has to ensure that, you know, especially bukan sahaja toilet bowl tau, some schools they prefer to put, you know, a plant kan. So all that can also contribute to breeding area. So macam we always forget, sebab kita selalu ingat rumah, so we always forget that school, apa nama tu, workplace, and then another place is like taman mainan, tapak binaan. Those are like heaven for breeding areas and people did not realize it. So selalunya, especially kalau sekolah, the bowl cannot be closed kan, so they have to ensure that they are regularly flush, maintain. So sometimes kan they are clogged, kan the water is clogged, and it just put just small clear water, and then it can cause a breeding area. So this is something like we always miss. So kadang-kadang kan when we have outbreak, when we go down there to tengok rumah, kawasan semua neighborhood very clear, tak ada apa-apa. So then when we sometimes it's very unusual place we found the breeding area. So we have like, you know, our inspector kesihatan, they have like very creative. So they have to go ups here, then you kena panjat atap, and then you sometimes it just at the septic tank you have just small opening, so you have like a lot of breeding area there. So it was very unanticipated area. So that's why idea kalau kat rumah is ourselves, our family, and then when we are talking about workplace, by right, school supposed to be a workplace for the teachers, can the school management, the hospital, so make sure that hospital management also kadang-kadang kan patient masuk sebab benda lain, and then they contracted with, so make sure that, you know, usually our UKA, the unit kesihatan awam, they will go around and then make sure that they are not area yang ada claw, yang ada sometimes just small defect, so it can contribute to breeding area. So it's require multiple community and organization commitment actually. So it's not only school, home, workplace, community member, everyone. So like macam Prof. Johari kata, it require collaboration and partnership. If not, kalau kita seorang je, it can't be done. So it's require collaboration and partnership from every aspect in community.
Okay, so we are approaching the end of our webinar. So before we end, we do a round table. So Dr. Tan, do you have any last message to give to our participants?
Yeah, dengue is dengue, if you detect early, there is a treatment. So you have to know how to identify you're having a dengue or not. You should have high suspicious on yourself when you have any fever without any other sign and symptom, like just a fever. Then you have high suspicion, you have to check for dengue. And please take care of your personal hygiene and your environmental hygiene. I know that this is very limited. However, I think our city planning also need to look into the over-rising, a lot of condo too close, too packed. It causes a lot of dengue. This is inevitable. So the policymaker, now I'm talking about policymaker, please look into this. Please look into this. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Tan. Then now go to Dr. Johari. Do you have a last word for our participants?
Okay. Yeah, I agree with what Dr. Tan mentioned. We have to respect dengue and we have to respect mosquito. So it's not only about can transmit dengue, but can transmit many other diseases, 3 or 4 important diseases in Malaysia. So actually, as far as mosquito is concerned, our behavior actually will decide whether we get, you know, close to mosquito or not. And of course, with my observation during the 2 years COVID-19, hiatus, dengue is not in the news, and I'm glad to hear that the numbers are less compared to the previous year. But are we detecting enough? Because we are so busy with COVID, we have put aside dengue, which have taken in so much life. So that is the thing that the take home message, that we respect dengue because it can kill. It can kill you or your family members, and also don't breed mosquitoes.
As a pet, sir. Okay, thank you, Dr. Johari. And then now, Dr. Siti Aisyah.
I totally agree with what Dr. Tan, Prof. Tan and Prof. Johari mentions that to fight with dengue, it starts with us. So we find, we destroy, we protect, and we prevent from dengue. At the same time, I always believe that we have to take ourselves as a part of community. So we have to play around and play our role and responsibility as community. And I think the collaboration, the connections and partnership with other agencies is very, very, very much important. So last time, kalau perancang bandar, they always thought that diorang bina and then the landscape, the architecture. Now they have to put the health part in when they are planning any town, any policy making, so that we can see that health is very important. The community health is very important, so that we can prevent. Now we prevent dengue. If we know with success, we can prevent other diseases related to this mosquito, like chikungunya, Zika. It's, you know, kill one bird, two birds with one stone. So basically, it starts with us. So with ourselves, we as an individual, and then we as a community, and we as a part of citizen nature. So if we play our role, I think we can solve this problem together.
I always, maybe I share my experience. I always have a habit, once I'm walking, when I see if there's any container, especially the cup, that bubble tea cup, usually you see bubble tea cup, people are just throwing, or any packing. Now, because of COVID, so everyone take a packing. So whenever I see some that's a water, I will just overturn all. If let's say there is no rubbish, rubbish tank, so yeah. I will just overturn at least, just to drain out the water and then not letting the water to accumulate. And with this, I would like to say thank you to all our three panelists for today's sharing with us on various aspects of dengue. And the responsibility is right on us, okay, to destroy the breeding sites of the dengue. So if not, then kita akan menanti maut lah. This is what the MOH is talking about to us, saying, giving us the message. And I would like to encourage the participants who are eligible to apply as a members for the academic Professor Malaysia. In the chat box, you can have the form, okay, pendaftaran. And also, if you want to request an e-certificate, kindly fill in the form, which is the link given in the chat. With this, I would like to say thank you to all our participants and our panelists, and also to academic Professor Malaysia to having this webinar on dengue, which is considered a very important disease in tropical, especially Malaysia. And today, 15 June, is Asian Dengue Day. And good luck to everyone, and stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.
Okay. Maybe kita boleh ambil a group picture, Doctor.
Yeah. So invite all the participants to, if you want to take a picture, then you just on your video, so we can take the group picture.
Please, 1, 2, 3, one more, 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you very much.
Hey, thank you everyone, stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Prof.
Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum. Salam sejahtera semua.
Thank you. It's a very good section. I've learned a lot of these informations. I don't know about